Hello, and welcome to Studio 41, presented by Chime. My name is Bobby Corella, digital content manager for the Dallas Mavericks, joined, as always, by Katia Villalba. Katia, what is up?
Hello, how's it going?
Oh,
I'm excited
going well.
To be here.
Oh, I'm excited to be here, too. We're coordinated. We're both wearing the blue.
Yes.
We're wearing the blue for Dirk, of course, who's our guy, who's the reason for the season. He's why we're here today. We're talking about, in the first ever book club in Studio 41.
Presented by Chime.
The Great Nowitzki, Basketball and the Meaning of Life by Thomas Pletzinger. We got me, we got Katia, we got Chopper in the back. We got the seat next to Katia, which represents chat, which represents everyone who's watching this, because book clubs are a communal experience.
Yes.
Reading a novel is a very intimate thing. It is a personal experience, right? You're the only person that's reading the book. It is all about you and the author and the subjects and everything. But when you come together as a club, as a group, as a team, to discuss the book, you can talk about the way that you thought, the way it made you feel, and then I can talk about the way it made me feel, and then we can just sort of really connect. And so hopefully people that are watching this, hopefully you've had the chance to read it. It is The Great Nowitzki, Basketball and the Meaning of Life by Thomas Pletzinger, available everywhere. If you haven't gotten the chance to get a copy, you can get one on Amazon, you can get one at Barnes & Noble, you can get one anywhere online. So definitely give it a shot.
They have it in audiobook as well.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Is that how you went about intaking it?
Partly.
Yeah. Was it good?
Yeah, it was good.
I've never listened to an audiobook before.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, I would suggest give it a shot.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So with so many German people in this, was it a German accent or was it just an American guy?
It was not a German accent, but the German words and the German names were pronounced very well.
That's important.
Yes.
That is important.
Yes.
I would expect him to also be able to pronounce y'all correctly.
That was also part of it.
Good.
Yeah.
Well, that's very good. So, okay. Before we start about the actual book itself, right? Because we are going to talk about that. We're not going to spoil everything. We know how Dirk's career went. They won the championship, guys. They did it in 2011. But before we talk about the actual book, Katia, you are a reader.
Mm-hmm.
You are a self-confessed, self-admitted reader.
Yes, I am.
What kind of books, what kind of things do you like to read? Do you read books? Do you read more short stories? Do you read articles? And if you read books, what kind of books do you like?
I like fiction because I kind of use it as like an escape of, like, instead of watching like a TV show or something like, or a movie, like I'll read. And I also like to read nonfiction in like, more like I'm very into like psychology type of books, but then I'm also into like true crime books.
Okay.
So this was different for me.
Not and much crime in Dirk's career.
No, yeah. No.
Except for what happened in 2006, right?
that's a good one.
Yeah, so it is kind of out of the realm of what you're normally used to.
It is, and I very much enjoyed it. I haven't read anything really like this to where it's you would think it's a like we've talked about, like it's a book about Dirk, but it's also about the supporting characters in his life that you may not know that much about. And it was really awesome to read little anecdotes and stories about, for instance, like Holger. Like, I feel like I learned so much about Holger.
Yeah, we don't really know much about that guy.
No, he's kind of a mystery.
Yeah.
And it was kind of cool getting the curtain peeled back on him and their relationship and how he mentored him and how they met. And even the author's interactions with Holger were very interesting, like the Starbucks one.
He's a whimsical guy.
He's a very whimsical guy. I heard he lives in a castle. So hear like all these, Holger does this or, you know, Holger does this. And I remember when I was traveling with the team, he was traveling in Dirk's last season with us. And he's just a magical dude.
He just does his own thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a very fantastical guy. And Holger himself also had a Holger who is just as sort of whimsical as well. And so even though Dirk, like we know all about Dirk, there are these other like fantastical, magical people around him. But that makes it, I don't know, it was almost like reading a work of fiction because you're like, there's no way that all this stuff can be true. Like Dirk is this very, we think of him as like this one-track mind guy. I do basketball and then I just kind of hang out, post funny tweets every now and then.
Yeah.
But Dirk learned basketball from two of the wackiest, wildest, most awesome people ever. And so we'll talk about them. It's Holger and this guy named Ernie Butler. So we're going
to
dig into that.
And you
as
have
well.
To think that Dirk has a fantastic sense of humor. And you can really see where he kind of gets that from with Holger. Because just some of the stories, you're just like, wow, this dude's hilarious. You just, sometimes it doesn't translate, but he's so funny.
Oh, yeah.
He's so funny.
Now, as someone who likes fiction, Kat, mm-hmm. I know you haven't read Lord of the Rings.
Oh. Okay.
So I have a recommendation for
you. Okay, thank you.
Lord of the Rings.
Okay.
Okay, just want to put that up. I just want to put that up. Okay, so a brief summary of the book. And now, obviously, Dirk played 21 years. He's been alive for much longer than just 21 years. I think he, what, is it going to be 44, 43? Look at Dirk getting up there. Yeah. Still looking great, living great.
Yeah.
But this book is about much more than just basketball, like we said before. And so to kind of give you an idea of how it's written, if you haven't been able to read it yet or haven't dug into it yet, or you have a copy of the book, but like KCat in the chat, you've only read 20 pages of it. The book is called The Great Novitzky, which is obviously reminiscent of The Great Gatsby. Now, if you've ever read The Great Gatsby,
That's a great book.
Yeah, very, very good. Yeah. It's kind of about this guy named Jay Gatsby, but it's not really about this guy named Jay Gatsby. It's kind of just about a lot of other people, and it's written from a first-person point of view.
Uh-huh.
The narrator, I guess, is Nick Carraway. This book is kind of the same thing. Now, it's not obviously imitating The Great Gatsby, different time and place and everything, but
it parallels it, though.
It kind of does, yeah, because Thomas Pletzinger, who's the author of this book, is writing the book as himself, but it's basically his experience getting to know not only Dirk, but also Holger, the other people around Dirk, Dirk's former teammates, Dirk's family, his parents, his wife, teammates, executives with the Mavs. It's kind of almost like a book about writing a book about Dirk, really, which makes it this very sort of like meta kind of not only a character study of Dirk, but also a character study of the author. And like he has to like convince Holger to let him write the book. And that's a scene at the beginning of the book. Like it's this very sort of like world kind of in and of itself.
Well, because the book originally started with him just coming to Dallas for 2 weeks during that playoff run. And what year was that?
It was in 2012. So the year after the Mavs won the championship.
Yeah. With the intention of meeting Dirk and only really meeting Dirk. And then he doesn't get to do that for, what, 3-4 games. And so he starts meeting all the supporting characters, starts meeting people in Dallas and learning that, like, whoa, Dirk is like this whole enigma almost of just like he means something different to every single person that he meets.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's kind of where the story elevates, and he kind of becomes the storyteller of what Dirk means to Dallas, to others, to everyone.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that was really cool because it starts with like the cab driver, where the cab driver is like, oh my gosh, you're going to be Dirk.
Yeah, he's like from Eritrea or something. Yeah, like he's not even from Dallas.
Yeah. You know?
And like one of the other characters that Thomas really gets to know throughout his stays in Dallas over the course of many years is a bell guy at a hotel.
Yeah.
Like he just...
Shelly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Everyone in Dallas knows Dirk. Everyone who really loves basketball knows Dirk. But Kat, like you said, he means something different to everyone else. And 100%. So I guess we have to do it now. What does Dirk mean to you?
He is that, like, I almost want to call him like the superhero, because he's like the hero that brought the championship here to Dallas. So obviously that means a whole lot. But he was also like so not misinterpreted, but I feel like he never, outside of Dallas, he never got the credit that I feel like he deserves, right? Like, yes, he won MVP 1 year and all that stuff, but like, he means so much more to the people of Dallas because of what he brought to Dallas. Also what he does for the community and just how he gives back and like him, Uncle Dirk, like all that kind of stuff is not stuff that is super widely publicized. So if you don't live in Dallas, if you don't follow his career, you don't really know everything that he means. And I think that is so important to dive into and to learn and to really appreciate him for more than just being a basketball player,
mm-hmm.
for just what he did for Germany, like on the German team and everything like that. Just I just think he's so much more than the guy that won the 2011 championship.
Yeah, I agree. I think that his kind of whole mission in life was to just be good at basketball. Like, and he's very real about it too. He'll just say, I'm just pretty good at putting a ball through the basket. Like there's nothing.
Yeah.
He was never like, this means more than just scoring 20 points a game. Like, but because he was so committed to just being a dude that could put a ball through the basket, he meant so much more to other people, probably because of that. You know, this sort of innate humility that he has, maybe even pessimism, a lot of self-doubt, all of these emotions that he was feeling within himself that would sometimes creep to the surface. Sometimes we know he was going through it, but this constant almost storm just raging within his own body of like, am I really that good? Am I really this important? Is this really worth it? That just fueled him to become so much better and so much more impactful than he otherwise would have been, I think, if he just knew he was hot stuff the whole time.
And to bounce off of that idea, that kind of makes him more approachable and more just like
more human.
Yeah, more human. Like, we all go through that imposter syndrome of like, am I really good enough, or, you know, do I really deserve this? And I feel like you see glimpses of that throughout this book, of when he questions himself, or, you know, whenever he just goes through tough times, and just the way he's able to be resilient and like come through. That's why I think it's a very much like a hero story.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And kind of the sort of the timeline that this book was written, it does dive into Dirk's childhood a little bit. There is some backstory, mm-hmm. and also into Thomas's early years as well, as a German citizen. Just like, how important was basketball in Germany? Spoiler alert, not very important.
Yeah.
Until Dirk became Dirk. And then all of a sudden, you know, when Dirk was a rookie, it was like the hipster sport. It was very niche in Germany. You know, it wasn't very popular. So it kind of chronicles that. But the timeline that Thomas is writing this book, the meat of his access was like 2016, 2017, through the end of Dirk's career.
Mm-hmm.
So we're seeing the final years.
Mm-hmm.
And so one of the things that you were talking about, Katsi, is like all of the doubt, all of the questions that he was facing, kind of posing himself, like this inner conflict, was like his final seasons.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of intimate details about Dirk's workouts with Holger whenever he was in his prime, but also of Dirk's treatment process whenever he's like 40 years old, hobbling up and down the court, taking 3, 4, 5, 6 hours just to get ready for a single game at that stage of his career. And there's this moment where it sort of sets in and everyone kind of realizes, like, this is it. You know, like, it's over. It's coming to an end. It's not worth it anymore.
Yeah.
And so you see this hero kind of, I almost really appreciate the book even more. And I don't want to give everything away, but like, I almost appreciate the book even more because it was written at the end of a hero's journey as opposed to at the beginning.
Peak.
Yeah, or at the peak.
Yeah.
Like, we all know what it was like to watch Dirk be Dirk.
Yeah.
But now we also know what it's like whenever he can't be that guy anymore. And that's very sad, but it's also very beautiful.
It is. It's a beautiful story. I very much enjoyed it. Like, I will recommend this book to anyone and everyone that is a basketball fan, or just, you know, in general, just you want to read a good story about, you know, someone who you think you know, and you just learn so much.
Mm.
Yeah.
So overall, I guess we've kind of talked about overall thoughts on the book, but overall thoughts on the book, on the story, what are some themes maybe, or a character that really stood out to you without diving too deep? Just kind of like, what is like your big sort of takeaway?
I think I've already said this, but Holger, he's such a mystery. You just don't really know. You always used to see him in the arena and he was kind of around, but just knowing like, okay, like, I didn't know Holger was a fantastic basketball player back in his heyday. He dropped like 100 points or 98 points or something like that. He could dunk. An afro. Like, what? Who is this man?
Yeah, there's like some pretty sick photos of Holger.
Yeah,
from like 1965,
cool.
You know? And you can tell he's different than all the other guys on the floor.
Yeah.
He's playing basketball in Germany. Again, basketball in Germany, you know, the West German national team was very good for a little while. I mean, you know, they had some Olympic success in the 60s and 70s and 80s, but it was the underground sport, you know?
And learning about how he kind of combined science with it too. Like, he would draw up the shot, you know, that Dirk needed at the angle and practice the angles and all that. And it's like, yeah, we all kind of knew that, but like, to really dive deep into it and be like, no, this is what's going to make you good. Or the different exercises he would make him do. And just all that, like, very unorthodox training that mm-hmm. he went through.
Yeah. And Thomas was able to go to a lot of these workouts, and it's not just Mavs practice facility or at the arena or on the court. We're talking like, go to Germany, to some remote little village in Germany, like an hour away from Dirk's house in Würzburg, where the out of bounds line is basically the wall of the gym, and the it's not gyms. Quite 94 feet long. You know?
No, the small gym stories were definitely like my favorite, because at that point, I think it was just Dirk, Holger, and Thomas in the room. And so just to have those fly on the wall personal moments, to be able to relive that through the stories is really awesome.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's not just working on basketball. Like when they're together in these gyms doing their one-on-one training sessions, or it's more of like a, it's not just training, it's almost like a study session.
Yeah.
Because what they're doing, and Thomas goes into very, very tremendous detail, obviously, in the book, but better than I can tell you right now, but they're not just like taking 100 jump shots or 500 jump shots. They're also working through very, very specific game scenarios. Like,
I love that.
You're up 7 with 40 seconds left. What do you do?
What's the
you
play? Know?
And he's posing these questions to Dirk and also saying, all right, let's go practice it. But also, Dirk is going around the world taking 50 shots from each spot. And Holger's asking, all right, down 4 with 2 seconds left, what do you do? Or like up 6 with 12 seconds left, what do you do? While Dirk is shooting.
That was one of my favorite scenes of the book.
Yeah, actually. So not only are you thinking about, all right, keep your fingertips, do the little fingertip thing that Holger always has him do with like the V or whatever. Yep. And not only get your feet straight, all right, bend down, okay. But then also like, oh my God, we need a 3-pointer. Do we go for 2 or do we foul or what are we doing? And then not only on top of oddly basketball, you know, scenarios, these specific ones, they're also talking about philosophy, especially if Dirk is struggling, because there are times when Dirk is extraordinarily human. Maybe he's tired. Maybe he's hungover. Maybe he's in a bad mood. Maybe he's missing shots.
Yeah.
And Holger, like, if Holger senses Dirk sort of straying a little bit off the path, sort of losing the handle, then Holger's going to pop him with a, what did Nietzsche mean whenever he wrote this? Like, it has nothing to do with basketball, but it's always exercising the most important muscle that you have, you know, up here. And that was very, I don't know, striking to me, because we always see basketball players say, like, when I step on the court, nothing else matters. Like, all I need to think about is basketball. But it really felt like for Dirk, like, sometimes not thinking about basketball was the secret, you know? Sometimes that was the solution.
Yeah. No, I thought that was really interesting, because, like you said, for so many of us, we think like that's all they think about. That's all that matters to them. But no, there's so much more surrounding that. Like these athletes, like they're humans. They go through all the emotions like us as well. And seeing him humanized in this way was just really special.
We are definitely taking questions. So we're streaming this live on Twitch, obviously. Definitely. If y'all have questions, if y'all have comments or anything, definitely feel free to add them in the chat.
That's the whole point of a book club.
Absolutely. It's a communal experience. That's what the empty seat is for.
Yeah.
You know, comments, questions, anything. The book isn't really about Dirk. Like I said, it's kind of about other people. And there's a scene, it's page 43 in the book,
a scene.
That's what you can call it.
That's
in the
fair.
Book. So, Thomas is getting coffee with Holger, and that's a common thing that they do. Holger goes to this one very specific coffee shop, very specific table in said coffee shop, just lays out all his papers and is just writing dissertations on whatever space and science and all that stuff. And sometimes he'll stop down to talk basketball too. And there's a scene early on in Thomas's project of writing this book where Thomas is basically pitching it to him like, I want to write this book about Dirk. And Holger's like, I don't know about that. Like, you know, they're very guarded people. But also, Holger gives this quote that I thought was just fantastic. So he says, he tells this story about this philosopher named Thomas Nagel, or Nagel, N-A-G-E-L, sorry, who he poses this question: what is it like to be a bat? Now, no one knows. We know everything there is to know about bats.
Right.
We know when they sleep. We know what their bodies are made of. We know how they
see.
How they see. Like, we know everything about bats, but we don't know what it's like to be a bat. We'll never know what it's like to be a bat. We just will never know. And Holger, like, first off, just pulls that essay out of thin air. Like, he just remembers it. Like, remembers that whole thought. And then Holger goes into this Friedrich Nietzsche, quote where he says, as a human being communicates himself, he gets rid of himself. And when one has confessed, one forgets. So basically, what he's saying is like, if Dirk talked about what it's like to be Dirk, not just what it's like to play basketball, but what it's like to be him. Like, if he reveals who he is, then he's not himself anymore because he's, like, given away the secret.
Right.
And not even in, like, some, like, cutesy or super metaphysical way. Just, like, genuinely, once you talk about what it's like to be yourself, then you're not really yourself anymore. And I think that's just very, that's extremely
deep. It's so meta.
Yeah. And Thomas says, Dirk Nowitzki couldn't express his innermost self, he said, because this stable core self would be lost if he did. Or it would become less clear at the very least, and consequently the ability to focus on what really matters would be lost. And so Holger is basically, and then they go on to talk about like string theory and my guy David Foster Wallace and all this other stuff. But
and Roger Federer.
And Roger Federer, which yeah. By the way, David Foster Wallace's essay on Roger Federer is amazing. It's just truly stunning piece of literature. But anyway, Holger, his reaction and his response to Thomas saying, I want to write about Dirk, is like, Dirk doesn't want to be written about,
yeah.
And he can't be written about, because if he is, he's not himself anymore.
Then he's not, yeah, he loses himself.
Yeah,
he loses
it's over.
His identity, because now it's like shared with the world.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And so Thomas's response to that was to say, all right, well, I won't write it about Dirk then. I'll just write about what it's like to write about Dirk. Kind
right.
of, you know, I'll go on a journey. I'll write about you. I'll write about Ernie Butler, who we'll talk about in a second. I'll write about Dirk's family. I'll write about other people, how other people see Dirk. The bell guy, the cab driver, people like me, like random fans on the street. Thomas is coming to games interviewing people that maybe this is their first Mavs game. Maybe they've been coming to Mavs games for 25 years. And that's kind of when the idea sort of sets in of like, all right, this isn't actually about just one guy. This is about the experience of knowing who this one guy is.
Yeah. Well, I mean, imagine if this was just a biography. Dirk was born on this day in this city, and he did this, and, you know, he went on to do this. It's not the same story.
Mm-hmm.
Because in order to learn who he is, you have to learn about who shaped him. And so I think that's why my favorite parts of this whole book were, like, the Holger things.
All right, so Holger, let's I don't want to give away every cool story, because
yeah,
the first few pages of every chapter is usually some insane Holger story. Yeah. And even Thomas himself will admit he's not sure if these are true or not.
Like the one where he was like going across on the rope. Yeah, and like, yeah. What?
He's literally doing a high wire act, trying to like climb, like sort of drag himself across this like barbed wire rope across like a canyon.
As
where if he falls, he's dead.
Yeah, like they're doing a trip, like in yeah. a van in the middle of nowhere. You're just like, what?
There's one way across the river, and if you slip, you die. And like Holger's like halfway across, and the wind starts blowing.
Yeah.
And he's like, okay. And his hands are bleeding, and it's like, this is it. You know, it's the moment of truth. And even Thomas is like, I don't know. It probably didn't happen, but like,
but it might have.
So many people say it did. I just kind of believe it, you know. And that is Holger. I think that's the way we meet him in this book, is this that specific scenario. And he's gone on, you know, to just become this legendary figure in Dallas sports history and lore. But Holger is a very kind of bohemian dude.
Extremely.
He is German, lived in Germany his whole life, mm-hmm. played basketball in Germany. Obsessed with basketball, learned from this guy, Ernie Butler. Again, we'll talk about Ernie in a second. Ernie made a very important contribution to the basketball dialogue as well. But Holger was very good at basketball. I mean, like Kat, you said, he mm-hmm. scored 100 points in a game. Like, he was like a revelation at a time when basketball was not the real, like, the thing.
The thing.
Holger was just kind of some dude that was good at something. It would be like if you were really good at some weird, like if you were really good at like curling or something. Like curling, cool sport, not super popular. So it just is kind of, all right, cool. So he never really achieved too much fame or fortune or anything from this. And so he started doing other things. He got really into science. At one point in his life, he and a buddy basically like retraced the steps of Alexander the Great's conquest from like Greece to all the way to India, like on foot.
Yeah.
Like he traveled across the entire United States in some rented van. Like, dude is just a hippie, just a straight up hippie.
And then his business card, what was it? It was Albert Einstein, the picture of Albert Einstein sticking his tongue out. And it was from the Institute of Applied Nonsense.
That's what he calls his basketball university.
It's fantastic.
The program that created Dirk Nowitzki.
Is the Institute of Applied Nonsense.
But that's like, obviously he takes his craft seriously.
100%.
But when that's the, when those are the rules that you set, this is all just silly nonsense. Yeah. Like, that just creates this sort of mood and atmosphere about
it's so good. You know what I mean? It's so good.
You don't know whether to believe it or whether it's like, is this a joke? Like, Dirk always calls things a circus. And even sometimes Dirk is like, this guy's such a clown.
Yeah.
But at the same time, like, he knows what he's doing.
100%. I mean, if a dude's going to make you frog leap across the court, like, there has to be a method to his madness.
Mm.
For sure. And I mean, you see it. To us, Dirk is one of the greatest basketball players that has played. So.
Yep. Yep. And yeah, so like Patrick says in the chat, yeah, Holger did play national team ball for Germany.
Yes.
But at the time, you know, this is, we're talking like the 60s. European players hadn't really come over to the NBA yet. And so basketball was like this, from an American perspective, a European being really good at basketball was like, all right, whatever. You know, who cares?
Yeah.
Like, guy's never going to come over here. There was definitely a wall built. And that's kind of one of the tragic things about it is Holger probably could have been in the NBA way back in the day. And who knows, maybe he would have had this like Pistol Pete Maravich kind of impact on style and expression on the floor. We'll never know because European players weren't allowed to play in the NBA at the time, or they just didn't. But how poetic is it that 30 years later, Holger's, you know, Holger's Frankenstein monster, as it's talked about in the book, would kind of be the guy to normalize Europeans coming over. So, like, it's just kind of, it's cool how it all come back full circle.
I mean, even at the very beginning of the book, the author, Thomas, is talking about how he went over to his friend's house, and then all of a sudden Sabonis was just hanging out there, just watching basketball, you know, having some drinks. And you're just like, wow, okay, like, these, they're not huge superstars that they are today.
Mm-hmm.
And
this is when Sabonis was like, Sabonis.
Papa, like, Sabonis.
Like,
right?
The man.
Yeah.
It's not like
2 years
ago. This is like Sabonis is like the GOAT.
Yeah, exactly. And so it just really goes to show just how, I guess, humble it is over there. I don't know if humble is the right word, but in the sense of just, it wasn't, they weren't a soccer superstar, basically, is what I'm trying to say. Soccer was like everything for them, and basketball was kind of like, okay, like, you're good at this other sport.
Yeah, if they were visiting a town, they'd find the local Lithuanian dude that lived there, they'd go have drinks with him.
Yeah.
Like, and that is an important background picture to paint, not only because you help understand, you know, it helps you to understand Holger's roots and Dirk's roots, but also there are scenes in this book. The book is basically a series of vignettes. So Thomas spent, you know, 8-10 years following around Dirk, and each chapter is kind of like a time that he was with Dirk.
Yeah.
And so it's sort of this out of sequence story. But he's with Dirk in China, where everywhere he goes, he gets swarmed by fans.
Right.
Or he's with Dirk on a commercial shoot in Germany, where it's just complete and utter chaos. Or he's with Dirk, you know, in different scenarios where he's just obviously this extraordinarily famous guy. And again, the book, it's kind of like Holger calling his basketball institute the Institute of Applied Nonsense. One of the first things you hear Thomas, or you see Thomas write about, is how unpopular, relatively, basketball and basketball players were. Again, relatively, they're successful, but like, they're not celebrities. And then fast forward, and now, like, Dirk is like this Goliath figure, this huge, important figure in Germany, arguably the country's most famous athlete, playing a sport that's not the number one sport.
Right.
It kind of helps you realize, like, it is just all a circus.
Oh, for sure. And Dirk completely paved the way for today's European players. So, I mean, would there be, you know, the Giannis that is Giannis now had it not been for Dirk? Like, it just makes you question these things.
Mm-hmm.
Because it opened up the doors and it made it all a possibility for all of those players to be able to transition into the NBA and become these superstars that they are today.
Absolutely. And, you know, basketball obviously was always a popular sport. You know, it's survived for a very long time. But because Dirk achieved what he did in the NBA, obviously it drew more eyeballs, not only from fans, but also more importantly from like basketball scouts, NBA scouts overseas, which did build those bridges, made those players more famous here, made these players more famous there. And then it became this, you know,
it bridged the gap.
Yeah. And Dirk is, you know, kind of the representative, sort of the avatar for all of that.
Yeah.
And rightfully so.
Yeah.
Rightfully so. Okay. So Ernie Butler was an American who was stationed in Germany during the war and after the war. Stayed over there, eventually popped back over to America for a little bit, moved back to Germany for good. Coached basketball, ended up playing basketball. Basketball guy. Hung out at the local jazz clubs where he meets this guy named Holger. And all of a sudden, they hit it off. They're two peas in a pod.
Holger drinks lemonade and cola.
Not separately.
Together.
Together.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That Spezza was referenced several times. So
yeah, Holger's really not turning up at the club. He's just sipping on his weird drink. and so they end up hitting it off, and they get to know each other. Now, Holger at the time was talented at basketball. He was like pretty good, but Ernie was like different. You know, Ernie was from America. Ernie brought over the way that Americans played the game,
right,
the way that Americans talked about the game. Taught Holger a whole heck of a lot. And He was Holger's Holger.
Yeah.
Exactly. He was Holger's Holger. They started working out together. They ended up playing pro together. They dominated together. They won a bajillion championships together. They're this legendary duo. But Ernie obviously was a little older than Holger. And so Holger passed on what Ernie taught him to Dirk and to many mm-hmm. other students along the way. But Ernie's greatest contribution to the basketball discourse is he was, at least as far as we know, in the Great Nowitzki book universe, the first person to say that basketball is jazz. And I'm sure you've heard many people say that. Dirk has talked about it. A lot mm-hmm. of other people have talked about it. But he was kind of the one that really brought it up, because Ernie himself played jazz. He played saxophone. That was kind of this relationship between basketball, which is a sport, to something so free-flowing and beautiful and, like, uniquely American as jazz, frankly.
Mm-hmm.
That had never really been explored, but it makes perfect sense.
Yeah, that chapter was very beautiful to me, just in the way they compared the two, the analogy between the practice and then also the mistakes. So if you were listening to jazz and all of a sudden you hit the wrong note, like, was that really the wrong note? Or did that just kind of just go with the flow? And that kind of was really cool to see it parallel with basketball or with any other sport like that. And then the practice to where you practice enough and all of a sudden these become muscle memories and you know what note to play and you know how to shoot your shot and all that. So I thought that was a really cool chapter.
Yeah, I mean, jazz is expression, right? Basketball is expression.
Yeah.
So that's very, you know, parallel. Like you said, you can hit the wrong note in jazz, but there are rules in jazz. There are rules in music, first and foremost. There are rules in jazz, but they're a little fuzzier.
Yeah.
And in jazz, you get the opportunity to explore, try new things.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you're going to fail. Sometimes Luka, he'll send a pass into the ninth row. Like, he sent a pass in Milwaukee. He was, like, really feeling himself.
Yeah.
And then he threw a pass. And we even said, like, it's only a matter of time before
and there it was.
And, like, literally the next trip down the floor, Luka slings one out of bounds. But that's part of creativity. It's part of finding something new. It's part of pushing the boundaries. You don't know if you can achieve something until you try it.
Well, because when he did that, he had the biggest smile on his face afterwards. And was just like, yeah, that's me. I'm just trying
fun.
Cool stuff.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
I'm just having fun out here.
And in jazz, sometimes you're going to try some sick solo. And now, you know, what's okay in jazz, cracking a couple notes, that's fine. It's all part of it. It's part of what you've created. What's not okay in jazz is if you change the key, is if you take a solo too long, if you upset Miles Davis. There are some things in jazz that you cannot do. There are some things in basketball you cannot do, but it's all about finding the limits, right?
Yeah.
And exploring those things. But also rhythmically, like what you were talking about, Ernie's playing the saxophone while Dirk is doing his drills, and Ernie is drilling into Dirk's mind. There's a rhythm to the game, too. And, you know, Dirk, all of his movements look so janky. And, like, sometimes he looked really rigid, especially later in his career. But he always looked sort of clumsy, gangly, like he could almost fall over. But he never did. But there was, even though he was moving in weird ways and doing weird things, there is such a rhythm to the game. Catch, pump fake, dribble, dribble, spin, fake, fade, shot, swish. Like, there is a very, very, like, underlying rhythm to everything that he would ever do, the way he'd dribble, the way he'd run, the way he'd spin, the way he'd talk, the way he'd act. It was all very, very regimented, even though what he's doing is always pushing the limits of what is possible and what we think about.
Yeah, I really enjoyed this part. It says, like athletes, musicians develop an arsenal of individual moves and standards. They create a toolbox and have to practice for a long time before mastering the tools. Athletes and musicians require routines and rituals. And they need maintenance.
They do.
So, yeah, I just thought that was a really, really, really good comparison.
Yeah.
And a really good way to, like, metaphorically bring the two together.
Mm. And just, like, fundamentally, if you're thinking about basketball as a sport, as this very, you know, militarized, almost like football, mm-hmm. you know, very, like, X's and O's, you go here, block here, block here, there's a gap there, run it to the end zone, touchdown, then you're thinking inside the box.
Yeah.
Right? But if you think about basketball as a way to create, if you think about it as a way to express yourself, and if you're talented enough to do that, then that's when you can really do something that people have never seen before.
Yeah.
And so not only is there this sort of element of you need to practice, you have to know all the rules, you have to nail all the easy stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Every virtuoso musician can play every note, play every scale, they know all the bits, they have everything memorized. But what separates Wynton Marsalis from idiot trumpet players like me is that he can do things that I didn't even know existed, you know.
Yeah.
Like, they can think in ways that we aren't even aware of, and that is where, you know, making that connection, like, I'm a basketball player, the object is to win the game, I got to set a pick and I got to roll to the basket, I got to pop out, I got to pump fake, you know, do all that stuff. That's all the easy stuff. I'm a basketball player, I'm going to do something that no one's ever done before. That's how you become like a legend.
100%. I think that basketball is a very unique sport in the way that it harbors a safe space for players to be their own individual selves. You don't have to, you are part of a team, but you are also a very unique identity on that said team. So you're allowed to have these big personas. I wouldn't say that they're egos. I mean, obviously there are some egos, but for the most part, you know, you have these almost characters of like, players, and I think that's very different than a lot of other sports.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And the way the game is played too. I mean, okay, people in football can do some wacky stuff, you know, one-handed catches and things like that, but if we're thinking the main sports, basketball and soccer, I guess hockey to a degree, but basketball and soccer are really the two most sports where everyone sees everybody, okay, so we all see the faces and everything.
Yeah.
But you have a lot of freedom.
Yeah.
To do some stuff. You can make some fancy moves. You can make mm-hmm. some fancy shots. You can try some new things. You can be very innovative. You can always push the limits. And I think that's what makes those two sports so aesthetically pleasing, and the experience of watching them so like riveting, because there's a chance when you watch a basketball game, especially if you have a player like Dirk mm-hmm. or like Luka, or you're watching a game with LeBron, or you know, the best of the best, you know, and make no mistake, Dirk was one of the best of the best. Steve Nash, another guy. They were teammates. Heck, that would have been cool. They spent their whole career together. But when you watch guys like that, there's always a chance in the back of your mind you're thinking, I might see something that I've never seen before.
Yeah.
And that excitement, like whether it's Dirk's first game or his 21st season, mm-hmm. just knowing I might see something that no one has ever witnessed, that always makes you feel like young, always makes you feel like I have to watch this game. I have to tune in to see what Dirk might do tonight.
It's that excitement of like when you spin the slot machine and it's going and you're like, I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know what's going to happen. And then all of a sudden you're like, bam, I won. Or, you know, you see something really cool. You're like, wow, that was.
I always win at slots. I never lose.
Okay.
Yeah. I never come up empty.
I don't know if that like directly... I don't know.
Anything
if that was
is
like,
possible.
Yeah, but exactly. It's just like you just don't know what's going to happen. And the excitement that you feel as that's spinning is the excitement that you feel when you're watching a game.
Yeah,
it captures
your imagination.
Yeah.
And that's like the great sort of. Because I don't know. The question that I have is Dirk an interesting character? Now, I don't know the answer to that. We can talk about that. I'd be curious to hear your take. But the reason I ask that is because Dirk publicly. Even Dirk privately is very guarded, very mm-hmm. closed off,
mm-hmm.
very much I'm going to the gym, I'm going to work out for 4 hours, I'm going to go home, I'm going to eat some pasta, I'm going to take a nap, I'm going to wake up, watch the game, go to bed.
Yeah.
Very much like a jock, you know, mm-hmm. just like the basketball man. And yet on the floor, he's a totally different person.
Yeah.
He's talking trash, he's creating, he's pushing the limits, he's doing the one-legged fade, he's doing things that literally nobody has ever done before. He's creating moves that everyone else is copying. He's creating training routines that Kevin Durant still uses to this day. Like, Dirk, the basketball person, extremely interesting. But it's so weird that there's this dichotomy of, like, Dirk, the person that we know, is such this like private, closed off. Mm-hmm. You think of him, the way his personality is, the way that he carries himself, you think like, this guy, he's more like Harrison Barnes. Like he's going to come in, take some jump shots and he's going to score. Yeah. And Harrison Barnes is great, but Harrison Barnes isn't Dirk. But like, you would not think that with the persona that Dirk has, with the way he carries himself, the way he talks about the game, you almost wouldn't believe that he's the guy that is doing all these neat moves and like that he's like changing the way the sport is played. You know, that is interesting. The way that he carries himself, I don't know if that's interesting, but the dichotomy, the disconnect between those two is super interesting to me.
That's what makes it interesting, because he's one person off the court and he's another person on the court. And I would say that off the court, he's allowed his privacy, and it's okay that he's not an interesting person, you know, because that's almost like the part that once he shares that's gone. And it's like they said in the book. And so him as a player, super interesting, love it. And I'm okay with him as a person not being interesting, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Which kind of, you know,
and I don't mean that. I don't mean that to be like in a disrespectful way of like, he's boring. Like, no, I'm sure he's a blast.
Yeah.
Like, I'm sure the people that know him on a personal level and are in his inner circle, I'm sure they have a completely different, you know, opinion on this.
Yeah.
But me as a fan, I'm okay with that part of him being like, I don't know that part of him. And that's okay.
Yeah. And it's kind of, you know, comes back to the Great Gatsby. It's called The Great Nowitzki. Once you actually know who Jay Gatsby is, you're kind of like, like
it loses the allure.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And that's the Nietzsche thing. Once you know about this guy, there's nothing to know anymore. So like you almost have to, not that it's a facade, but like a wall, you have to create a separation. Like no one really knows who I am. I know you very well. I don't know who you really are.
Right.
You know, you don't know who I really am. Like, that's part of what makes us human. And I think like the reason that we're able to relate so much to Dirk is because not only of all the times that he tried and failed and then finally succeeded, it's a very like very heroic story, but also because he seems superhuman.
Yeah.
He really does seem just like us. No one really knows about Dirk. I almost don't want to know
about Dirk. Exactly.
I don't want to.
Yeah.
Because once I do, there's...
The illusion is gone. Or,
yeah.
Or that,
and it's not like he's a jerk. He's a great dude. Dude, like,
yes.
Dirk is a saint.
Yeah, I think the best way to kind of explain that is for so long he went and did the children's hospital rounds and he never let press in and he never let the media in. And it was just something that he would go do on his own and he would just go and do it privately and he didn't need the pomp and circumstance and all that. Like, he didn't need that. And I think when he let the media in on that, like his last, like you could see how much that meant to him, because in his last game when they showed the Uncle Dirk and he cried.
He broke down.
Like,
he was sobbing.
Yeah, it was just one of those moments where you're like, wow, like there's so much about him that I don't know. And like the side that those kids saw of him, it's like that's special to them. And you should leave it at that.
Mm-hmm.
Like you shouldn't have like... The normal person shouldn't have to experience every side of him.
Mm.
Does that make sense?
It's an all-encompassing, consuming culture that we live in. We want to know everything about everyone all the time.
Right.
Reality TV, I need you to tweet 37 times a day. I want to know who you are. I want to see what no one else sees. And I want you to share that on your Instagram where everyone else will see it. And you can make money off it. But it's genuine. Okay, it's genuine, even though it's supposed to make your brand look better. But it's okay, it's who you really are.
Right.
Like, there is this sort of, it's just a game. It's a charade. Whenever we were having tech difficulties earlier, people wanted us to play charades. It is just a charade.
Yeah.
But because Dirk doesn't really partake in any of that stuff, the things we do see are the genuine. Mm-hmm. It's genuine. It's all real.
Yeah.
You know, it's not nonsense, even though Holger wants it to be. Even Holger's playing the game. He's calling it nonsense. Obviously, it's not. But
it's
like
not.
When you call it that, it disarms you. It's just this, I don't know. He's just lived a very interesting life.
Completely.
Holger has, Dirk has, Ernie Butler has. And there's a lot more in the book too. I mean, Thomas goes to like a surf town, sort of like on the beach, and talks to one of Dirk's former teammates who won championships in Germany and then just like is just teaches surf lessons now.
Chose to do the van life,
yeah,
right?
Just yeah. Like, yeah, he's just yeah. hangs out, plays guitar, you know,
yeah.
goes wherever it's warm, basically, is what he says. I think he spends half the year, like, in Hawaii or something. Like, he just teaches people how to surf. Like, yeah. that's pretty cool. All right. There's all of these, and all of these people are uniquely, like, kind of just bohemian. I guess I keep saying that word because they live in Germany, but, like, they're just all hippies and hipsters. And then you realize Dirk spent his entire life around these people, so he's really that way, too.
Totally.
Like, the rule is you're the average of your five closest friends at any given time.
Oh,
right?
Okay.
You are who? What? You take your five closest people, throw them together, that's who you are, right?
Oh, I love that.
All of Dirk's closest people are kind of like a bit, like, a little wacky.
Yeah.
You know? And that tells you a lot about Dirk without even having to know a lot about Dirk.
Yeah.
Like, Dirk spends a lot of his time with Holger. I bet that Dirk and Holger are pretty similar.
Yeah. The most iconic moment of Holger, I think, is whenever Dirk hit, I believe it was 30K, or when he moved into six.
It was 30K, 30K.
30K with the single tier.
Yep.
That shot, like, wow.
And you know who's sitting right next to Holger in that video? Thomas Pletzinger.
Wow.
Yep. So Thomas was at that game. That was kind of whenever he started writing the book.
That's cool.
Yeah.
That's really cool.
Yeah. And so there are all these achievements. I mean, I don't know. You had a really good question. You had a really good question.
Okay. Yeah. Let me find the.
It's like 137 or something. I don't remember.
Something like that. Let's see.
I've been holding off on going there, but I want to go into
though.
That now, and I'm curious to see what everyone in chat thinks about it as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, I want to know too. Okay. So basically, I can't find it right now, but it's saying that, like, anyone who is famous is kind of stuck in that. In one moment in people's minds. So the way Thomas Pletzinger puts it, Audrey Hepburn is always outside of Tiffany's. Michael Jordan is always, you know, six ring Jordan. So I'm sure we all have different answers to this, but what moment in time is Dirk stuck in your memories of him?
So, like, when I think of Dirk, what am I thinking about?
Uh-huh.
Man, that is such a good question. And
it's so
the
deep.
Thing is, like, it is different for every... I would expect everyone's answer to be different. Like, if you think of Dirk, what is the first thing that comes to mind? There is a moment. It's not just a face. He's doing something. I think that my moment in time that Dirk is frozen in, and not to try and be super interesting, is a nondescript game where he's spinning and taking a technical jump shot with just nasty footwork that just sends some dude to the shadow realm. Like, he's just eviscerating some big man that's not ready to guard him. There's nothing special about the game. There's nothing special about the stakes. But I feel like that's really representative of him, too, because he was so consistent for so long. Like, no matter who he was playing against, he was going to do the same stuff. He was taking it seriously. And I think that's my Dirk moment. At home, spinning, tongue out, kind of looking like villainous, sort of like spin, launch the fade, and he hits. That's my Dirk thing.
So I found the chapter, and I want to read this paragraph because I think it's so good. It says, superstars exist outside the realm of time. They're frozen in their iconic moments. George Clooney always looked like George Clooney. Audrey Hepburn will forever be standing in front of Tiffany's. In my mind, Michael Jordan will stay the Michael Jordan of his sixth world championship forever, even though he's now a heavyset man in his mid-50s, which is like, okay, tell me how you really feel.
But that's also humanizing.
It is, like, 100%.
Father time undefeated, man.
It's almost like superstars larger than life are not bound to the passing of time. Their hit movies, their most famous videos, their greatest games will always define them. And I can't help be surprised when they grow old. Like, that's so beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
For me, I think of Dirk. I think him hugging Jet in game six. Just, like, that bond, that friendship, that trust, everything. It's, like, that when I picture Dirk, that's the moment that I picture. Like, also,
misty-eyed.
Yes. Yeah. Like, because it was that moment that he knew.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I did it. We did it.
And it's a beautiful moment for so many reasons. They went through so many losses together and everything, but, like, throughout that entire series, Dirk and the entire Mavs were really trying to, like, fend off Father Time, age, doubt, you know, losses that you've had before. But in that moment, like as the tidal wave of relief is sort of washing over them, they also look old. They look tired. Yeah. They look like they've been through hell, yeah. which is true. They it were. Is. They yeah. were old and they were beaten down. They were exhausted. But like you finally see them like there's no more like angry face. There's no more game face.
It's like, when the relief like washed over them of like, oh, wow, like we did it.
It's just amazing that they got that on camera. Like, I'm so yeah. grateful that we no, didn't. That's what if that happened? We didn't
iconic,
even see it. You know?
Iconic. It still gives me chills. Just yeah. like it's so iconic and like just it's such an awesome moment in time. And then I love the part when he talks about after they've won the championship and it's Scooter and Dirk and they're at the Loon and all of a sudden the game six comes on the TV and it wasn't planned or anything like that. And the championship trophy is sitting right there on the bar and they're watching the game. And he says, and then the doubt came in of like, can they win this? Are they going to win this? And they're actually watching the game as fan. And then all of a sudden they had that moment of like, we did that. We did that. And like, I thought that was a really, really cool scene.
Yeah. There's even disbelief because again, I mean, I'd say this all the time about Dirk, like his story is kind of one of so many failures, which made his yeah. triumph that much sweeter because yeah. he tried so many times and couldn't get there. And it's like, you have to reprogram your mind. In 2007, they won 67 games, lost in the first round. Yeah, he won MVP,
yeah.
accepted his trophy after being upset by the 8 seed.
Yeah.
He went to Australia with Holger for like a month and just like disengaged with society because you have to reprogram this thing to remove the doubt. Yeah. You have to believe the next time is going to be the time. And for so many years, the next time wasn't the time either.
I know.
And the time after that wasn't either. Time after that wasn't either. And so you could see in this moment, even after they know they've won, Dirk is still hung over.
The championship trophy is sitting yeah. right there.
I couldn't imagine celebrating a championship for like a week. I would just have a headache just like for 196 hours. But like, it's there. Yeah. They know they've won.
Yeah.
And yet they still are like, did we though?
Like, did that really happen?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I just think that's great. It's great. But yeah, there's TX Dad in the chat says that one of the memories that he has of Dirk is the time that he high-fived his son. And I think that's awesome because like, that's what he would do, man. I mean, yeah. every single person, if you go to the Heroes baseball game that he has, every single fan that goes,
stays for hours,
he's going to sign their autograph. Literally hours.
Thousands of autographs, thousands of people meeting him. And that leads us to the scene in the Hillstone restaurant where...
Oh, yeah.
That is such a good scene in the book as well. They're all out having dinner and a fan comes up and is like, hey... my daughter is a huge fan. Can they come take a picture with you? And it says that Scooter in the book was like, really, dude, come on. Like, we're clearly having dinner. Like, really? And Dirk was like, yeah. And then they talk about the punked scene when the kid was just showing up with like baseball bats and
like a Kobe jersey.
Kobe jerseys. Yeah. And Dirk was just signing away. Who was he with?
Al Whitley and Michael Finley.
And, Finn.
And they were in on the joke.
Yeah, they were in on the joke, but they were just like, what are you doing? Yeah. Like, what's going on?
But Dirk is like, I don't know. It's just a kid. Like, yeah. what am I supposed to do? You know, and like, it's not just, you know, he signs autographs out of the goodness of his heart. It's not just because he feels bad, but like, that is. Dirk will sign your baseball bat, you know, yeah. like he'll high five your kid. He'll
the other really good one was whenever they were going to that small gym somewhere in Germany and the janitor was like, hey, can I get a picture just, you know, to capture the moment? And Dirk was having a really bad day and he was like, no, not right now. But you know what? Next time or another time. And they were leaving and they were already in the car on the way. And he said, oh, no, we have to go back. I forgot something. And he went back to take the photo with the janitor.
Dude, what a guy.
Yeah.
You know, what a guy.
Yeah.
What a freaking guy. Has there ever been a relationship like Dirk and Holger, not just in the NBA, but in any other field? I mean, I'm sure there has, just like mentor-mentee kind of. Now, has the pupil ever reached the heights that Dirk did, becoming one of the however many, whatever your list is, one of the 15, 20, 30, 50 best players of all time? Or best in their field of all time,
right.
I'm not sure. But I'm sure there's been, I mean, you go back all the way to like Plato and Socrates, right?
Mm-hmm.
They were understudies or one learned from the other. I mean, I don't know. I think that's what makes it so unique too. And now, you know, LeBron has someone he learned from. Kobe had someone Everyone he learned does. From. Everyone learns from somebody. But like Dirk is 40 years old and Holger's still making the trip from Germany to Dallas and they're still doing their same workout routine. And Holger's in his 70s and he's still getting down and with the leather jacket on and, you know, telling Dirk, like, get your feet, bend your knees. You know, like, I've watched them work out together before. They don't talk. It's true. They don't talk. Sometimes they'll talk about philosophy. They don't talk about basketball. It's all unspoken. They're still doing the same routine when Dirk is on top of the world and actually coming down from the top of the world as they did before. They're both old men and like Holger's still chasing rebounds. Like
it's incredible.
I don't know that there is ever one because normally you think of like once the student becomes the master,
that's it.
That's it. Yeah. It's over. I have nothing to learn from you anymore. Like I'm going to learn from someone else or I'm going to team up with superstars or I'm going to do like my work here is finished.
Right.
But like in Dirk's mind, he never became the master.
Yeah. That's incredible.
I think
you put that beautifully. Yeah. Like I have nothing to add to that. Yeah, like it's incredible.
Just innate humility. This is what it is. Yeah. You know, I think it's a very German thing too. If there's any Germans that are watching this or that watch this on YouTube or whatever, let us know. But the way that Thomas puts it, because I've gotten to know Thomas pretty well, and I think we're actually going to have him in studio here in a couple days because he's an American now promoting the book. But Thomas says like Germans are this sort of like inherently kind of pessimistic, like inherently have like a sense of, I don't know, shame or doubt or something. And we see it with Maxi all the time. Like Maxi's shooting slumps last longer than the average players. Like Dirk, he wins the MVP, but it doesn't matter because they lost. Like they just have this sort of sense of like the glass is half empty. And I think that if you can channel that and use it to fuel you, then like, you know, life is always going to humble you, but if you're always humbling yourself too, then like you're always going to learn from it and get better.
I was just going to say, like, if you keep a humble mindset, I think that you always have room to grow and room to learn. And I think that's very important because once you feel like you've reached the peak of what you're trying to reach, then you stop learning, you stop growing. And I think him keeping himself humbled and Holger reminding him like, hey, no, like you still got more to go, like, or like you still have more to learn or whatever it may be, I think that helped push him to be who he is. He played 21 seasons, one team. Like, that is the definition of, you know, just, I don't even know. I don't even know the word. Just.
There's no word for
there's
it.
There's no word
Dirkness.
For it. Yeah.
Dirkness. There's a great quote from a book that Phil Jackson actually had his basketball players read back in the day. It's about mindfulness and kind of Zen and spirituality and stuff. And it goes something like, in the expert's mind, there are many possibilities. In the beginner's mind, there are few. And the kind of the gist of it is, if you're actually an expert, first off, no one is an expert. But if you're trying to become an expert, if you're trying to master a craft, if you're trying to improve at something, you have to always be thinking about other ways to do it, new things to try, new ways to operate, ways that you could be wrong. Answers to find. You always have to question.
Yeah.
If you're a beginner, if you're a simpleton, if you think you know, if you think you're hot stuff, then
you're going to get humbled.
Yeah. Well, you're not going to think of, there are going to be few possibilities in your mind. You're not going to think that there are other things that you could be doing, other ways to improve, other things to try, other approaches to take, other kind of ideas to think about and philosophies to explore and stuff. And so for Dirk to always keep this kind of beginner's I might have got it reversed. But anyway, to always have this sort of mindset of like, I have so much to learn.
Yeah.
You know, then you're not, you're never going to be satisfied with how good you are.
Yeah.
I mean, he was the MVP. He was arguably the best player in the NBA from like 2005 to 2007. He was like the king of the NBA.
For sure.
But he never let it get to his head. You know, and he was never satisfied. Like, he kept getting better.
Right. Yeah. No, I love that. I think there's something to be said about his work ethic, and there's definitely a lot of props to be given there because a lot of people would hit, you know, MVP and be like, okay, well, I did it. But he knew that it wasn't about him personally getting MVP. It was about getting the championship for the team, and that was the goal. He's not a self-serving
It was never for
person.
Him.
It was never for him. It was always about what he could do for the team.
It was for us.
Yeah.
To correct myself, I did get it reversed. In the beginner's mind, there are many possibilities. In the expert's mind, there are few. There you go.
So you always got to keep that beginner mindset of like, I have so much to learn and there's so many things that I don't know.
Mm. See, you should always prepare, folks, because you might get a quote reversed and that would be very embarrassing. but yeah, don't adopt the expert's mind. If there's one thing to take away from Dirk, it's like he was always a student. He still is Holger's student.
Yeah.
He's not even playing anymore. But he's always a beginner because then you're always going to be thinking. You're always going to be trying to improve. If you think you're an expert, if you start thinking that your ish don't stink, then all of a sudden, like Katya said, life will humble you because it's going to humble all of us one day, you know. And that's, there you go. That's a little nihilism too. And like Holger always talks about Nietzsche, like Nietzsche's a nihilistic guy. I mean, not super nihilistic, but like, you know, they're very realistic people, Holger and Dirk. They don't, you know. They're very realistic. So anyway, it was awesome. Are there any other themes or snippets or ideas or thoughts that you had that you want to share? We've been going for about an hour now.
Yeah, I think we covered the majority of them. I just highly recommend this book to like anyone that wants to, you know, read just like a feel good story about someone who you think you know, but you don't really know.
Real quick. Okay, so like you said, we think we know Dirk.
Yeah.
You and I have followed this team closer than most for many years now because we've been working here and all that stuff. But to me, it felt like there was a whole load of stuff in here that I'd never heard of before. Was it the same way for you? Because it feels like so many people know Dirk having watched him so long, but that's not the case with this.
Yes. I mean, there was a lot, the times that he doubted himself and all that. Like, I had no idea, you know, what the off seasons were like, because that's the time where you don't really see him. You don't really know what he's doing. He disappears, right? He just goes overseas, disappears. So getting an insight into that was really cool. Also, I thought that the way that Thomas sets scenes in the book is really beautiful. Like the way he set the 41-21-1.
Mm-hmm.
Like that was really cool. And the way he set like the 30K night, like that was really cool. And it just because I mean, I was there, right, for 41-21-1, but I was in the broadcast truck, and I was there, but I was so far removed that I wasn't there. Mm. Same with like his retirement jersey night. It was like I was there, but I was so far removed that I really wasn't there. So being able to like get the experience of like what it was like to be in the arena, in the bowl, in the moment, was really cool to me.
Sometimes in Dirk's car with him on the way to that thing. Like Thomas is everywhere in this book, and kind of like you said, I was also at 41-21-1, but I was only there in my own mind. Like, my only memories from that night are things that I saw or did myself.
Right.
There are other things that happened that I didn't see or that I didn't know about.
So just, like, the way that he talks about going to his final home game and, like, they were in the car together and it was, like, how, you know, he pulls up to the security line or, you know, all that. Like, all that stuff is just, like, a very personalized moment that you're not there for, but now you feel like you were kind of a fly on the wall for, which was really cool.
Yeah, so even if you watched every dribble Dirk ever took, every shot he ever made, every shot he ever missed, you watched every game he ever played, you've read, there have been other books about him. There's a book recently by Zach Crane that's also super critically acclaimed. Mm-hmm. Definitely recommend that one as well. I See You Big German, I believe is what it's called. Even if you read every book about Dirk, watched all his games, there are things that are in this book that you have definitely never read, never heard of, never thought about. We've only scratched the surface. I mean, this thing is pretty meaty. It's like 400 plus pages. We talked for an hour about it.
And there's so much more we could
talk. Oh, so much more.
So much more.
There's so many more other, like we didn't even talk about Dirk's parents, his family.
Yeah.
Growing up in Germany, didn't even want to be a basketball player. Like,
play tennis.
There's a whole other side to this whole thing that we haven't even explored. So there's a whole lot in here. But yeah, definitely 1,000% recommend it.
I also loved in the prologue how he said something like Dirk's down there practicing, and then upstairs in a suite, there's, you know, the 4-5 legends that they brought in to surprise him are all cheersing to him.
Mm-hmm.
And then it talks about Barkley, and then there's the infamous Charles Barkley story of when Dirk dunked on him when he was like a teenager, and it says in the book like he'll go on to tell this story forever and tell it multiple times. It's like we've all heard that story, but it's really cool to just kind of see it from his perspective and from just the originating stories of it, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, this book is told through Thomas's eyes. Thomas is German. Thomas loves basketball. Thomas is very frank, says, I didn't really know who Dirk was until he was like pretty good. And most Germans didn't even know who he was either until he was like super good. So you're watching, you know, we knew who Dirk was as a Mav before Thomas did, before Germans did. And so like that is interesting as well. I mean, there's a whole, it's super interesting. Much. Thomas tells the story of the first time he ever saw Dirk, which was with the Würzburg X-Rays back in, you know, whenever they were fighting for promotion. Dirk skipped one of their games to come to try to come to the draft, to come try out for the Mavs. I mean, there's a whole lot of stuff in here. So really, really, really good book. Really good book. You can get it on. Oh, was there another thing?
Oh, no.
Okay.
No, you're good.
Okay. I didn't want to. If you had. I saw you circle into a highlighted thing.
Oh, like, yeah. No, it was the Barkley story because it just says Dirk got better with each telling. So it just goes to show how like legend grows, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. That's such a good line.
Yeah.
Such a good line. All right. Well, this was really fun. Katya, thank you for
joining us. Yeah, no, I was really glad we were able to like share this moment.
Absolutely. Yeah, no, great book. It is Dirk Nowitzki. Well, The Great Nowitzki. It's about Dirk Nowitzki. The Great Nowitzki, Basketball and the Meaning of Life. Chopper, behind the scenes, thank you for helping make this happen. To all the viewers on Twitch, thank you all for watching and hanging out. Hopefully you have a chance to read it as well. And if you watch this on YouTube or anywhere else, definitely check it out. Highly, highly recommend.
Let us know what you think. Like, I would love to have like these discussions with like other people and like just kind of talk about the book with others as they read it. It's just it's been really cool. Like, I have read it over the past week or so, and I would come in every day and be like, oh my gosh, Bobby, I just read this part, and it was really cool. Like,
yeah,
so it's a really cool experience.
It's so good. It's stories we've never heard about a guy that we're never gonna stop talking about.
Yeah,
you know, I mean, it's just
Dirk
is. He's going to be a central part of our life for the rest of our lives.
Forever.
You know, and so it's just cool to know more about him. And for sure. Cool to know more about the people that made him him. Yeah. But anyway, The Great Nowitzki, Basketball and the Meaning of Life by Thomas Pletzinger, available anywhere you get your books. Would super duper highly recommend. Not even a hashtag ad. We're just doing it because it was just that dang good. Yeah. Katya, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you all for watching and hope you have a great rest of your day. We will be streaming in Studio 41 presented by Chime. Tomorrow and every other weekday at 10 a.m. Central Standard Time. We'll be talking about all the Mavs games last week of the season. It's the home stretch. Super duper duper ultra exciting time to be a basketball fan. So we will be back with you tomorrow. And like I said, every weekday until this thing is over with. Hopefully when Luke is singing We Are the Champions sometime in mid-June. But we'll just have to see. We won't know until we get there. So let's just enjoy the ride together. And we'll see you tomorrow.